Thank you very much for the very kind invitation, and I'm really sorry because today I'm not in the best of the condition to lecture. I have fever, so but I just saw that this morning the article appeared on archive. So if worse comes worse, you can read the article. So I will do my best. And let me start with the theorem of Simpson, which is a motivation. So before I start with the theorem of Simpson, I have to remind you of the following, that if we take a group here, pi, which is an abstract abelian group of finite type, then, if we fix a ring, A is a ring, the functor which assigns to A algebras a group which assigns to B, B being A algebra, home of pi to B, to the units of B, I apologize, this is representable. And apply to the following situation. So if X is a quasi-projective variety, over the field of complex numbers, then we take capital pi to be the homology of the underlying complex variety. And this is usually denoted by the character variety. And I will use this notation here, pi. And then if I need to fix a ring here, I will put A. So as well known, so this variety here, if pi has no torsion, then this variety is a torus. And if pi has torsion, then if the torsion is invertible on A, then this so I forgot to say this is a group scheme, maybe that's the first information, over A. And if pi has torsion, and let us assume the torsion is prime, is invertible on A, then this is just it's a group scheme, and the identity component is a torus, and the quotient is an étale scheme over E. So let me write. Then we have here a torus inside of the character variety and a finite étale group scheme. So this is a very classical reminder. And Simpson proved the following absolutely remarkable theorem, which I'm going to recall now. So he assumes that X is a smooth projective over C. And he considers the character variety of X. So character variety of X, and now over C, So the points of the character variety here are just a rank one local system, rank one complex local system. And because we do a complex geometry here, there is a Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. So let me write RH for Riemann-Hilbert. Which equates this torus, or nearly torus here, with a variety which is an extension of an abelian variety by vector space, by a vector group, and let me denote it by Pick-Nabla. So this is also representable functors, and the points here of Pick-Nabla are rank one connections, rank one vector bundles with an integrable connection. And then, so this correspondence here, so this is a group scheme, this is another group scheme, and this equation here is viewed as C analytic varieties. And he proved that if S here is a closed subset, so let me write Simpson here. He proves that if S is a closed subset which has a property, so that means it's algebraic, which has a property that the Riemann-Hilbert of S is also a closed subset, then S has to be a union, a finite union, of A plus T, where T is a subtorus here. T is a subtorus, and A is any point. A is some point in S. Those are the irreducible components. Of S. So it's now in our days a very classical theorem, and it is absolutely essential. And in addition, if X together with S together with the Riemann-Hilbert of S are defined over a number field, then he proves that A can be taken to be a torsion point. So. Said differently, there are enough torsion points on S which enables one, on each irreducible component, which enable one to write this. So that's a fundamental theorem of Simpson, and out of this, he draws a consequence, so one possible consequence is if we fix a complex here, which has constructible cohomology and which is bounded with C coefficients, then the jumping loci of F are of this shape. Then, so we define the jumping loci of F as being the L in the complex point of the character variety such that the dimension of HI F tensor L is at least J, and then this is also of the shape union of A plus T, and T is a subgroup scheme. Okay, so those are the motivating theorems, and more than motivating. So the problem we address is the following one. So the problem we address as underlined above here, the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence is complex analytic. So it does not really exist in algebraic geometry, algebraic really algebraic. So what is an algebraic substitute for it? So what is? And when I say algebraic substitute, then I should say an arithmetic substitute, because clearly one has one needs more than the Zariski topology in order to prove the same theorem differently or a variant of it. So what is an arithmetic analog? Of Simpson's theorem. And remarkably, we will see in a minute that in fact one can really give a complete analog which yields the same strength as a result. I mean, which is a formulation which is as convenient as this one. So in order to explain, and if time permits at the very end, I'm going to say one word on higher rank representations of the fundamental group here, just one word as a conjecture. So, one can draw the following diagram. So first, let me explain what are the ingredients of the answer. So as already defined here, I'm going to consider. So, and in fact, we don't need x smooth here. The datum here is x normal quasi-projective over C. And then we consider the character variety. But then we are not going to consider over C. We fix a prime number. And we are going to consider over QP bar. So that means the QP bar points here, because it's representable, are the home of capital pi into the units of QP bars. That means rank one local systems with QP bar coefficients. And this, of course, it receives the points of it. And because it's representable, this is the same as the point of the character variety viewed over ZP bar with coefficients QP bar. So that's the representability. And of course, this one receives injectively the ZP bar point. But now, when we have representation of this discrete abelian group here of finite type into the P bar, then it factors through the profinite completion of capital pi. So let me denote by little pi the profinite completion. And let me write here in words what I mean is that if we have a homomorphism of this abstract abelian group of finite type with values in the units of the ring of, of integers of QP bar, then this one being profinite, then it factors three through little pi. So this group which I have written here, it is the same as a ROM of little pi into the p bar cross, and from those the continuous one, because the way it factors here is just via the profinite completion, so this one is continuous and this one is abstract. And now, by the very definition of a continuous homomorphism from this profinite little pi with values in the units of the p-bar, by the very definition of the continuity, this homomorphism is the same as, so I apologize, the board is going like this, this is the same as the continuous homomorphism of little pi to QP bar cross. So let me rewrite here. So I just, because my board is not very well organized here, let me just rewrite here the map from here to here. So we produce like this a map from the continuous homomorphism from little pi to QP bar cross into the character variety viewed over QP bar. In fact, the character variety, I didn't underline this, but it's defined over Z. And this is the first thing. Before I comment on this map here, let us observe the following. Is that now assume, because X, so I will write here, X is a quasi-projective variety, which we assume to be normal to be sure that our fundamental groups are the correct fundamental groups. Then it is a finite type, and consequently, X is defined over a field of finite type over Q. So let us denote by F here in C. This is a field of finite type over which X is defined, with X defined over F. So this F comes just by the very definition as a subfield of C, and consequently we can consider the closure of F inside of C. And this embedding here defines for us one Galois group here, so G being Galois of F bar over F. So what did we win here by writing this? Is that, of course, the Galois group acts on the profinite completion of the homology here, of the complex homology. So consequently, G acts here. So having S here, starting with S here as Simpson, but only on the Betti side here, we can consider the inverse image. So now this inverse image could be empty. And to say that it is empty, it is saying that S, let me call points, so let me call those just to have a name, not a very precise name here. Let us say those are the integral points of S. I think it's pretty intuitive to call them integral points because as we saw here in the very definition, points of S, those maps to points here, to QP bar points of S, and they are integral because they come from ZP bar points of S, i.e. phi of phi inverse of S, that's precisely S of the p bar. That means local system which are integral here. So those are the integral points. Maybe they are none, but if they are, so here I have to think are perfect. So if it's not empty, so if it's empty, I have nothing to say. But if it's not empty, then the second natural question is because the group in which it is living is acted on by the Galois group, then one very natural condition is whether or not this subset here is Galois invariant or not. And now I'm in the position to formulate the theorem. So the assumption as R written on the board here, X is normal quasi-projective over C, P is a prime number, and S is a closed subset here, so maybe I should, so S. Then assume that phi inverse of S is non-empty, and assume that it is acting on, it is stabilized by the action of the Galois group. Then we can look at the components of S, which contain integral points. Then for any S prime in S component, because if phi inverse of S is not empty, then there are components such that phi inverse of this component is not empty. So for any component here such that phi inverse of S prime is not empty, then S prime is of the shape E plus T, where A is a torsion point and T is subtorus. So I think it's a perfect analogy here. And of course, it has consequences. So in the theorem of Simpson, so on the jumping loci, So if we take Simpson's theorem on the jumping loci, if we assume in addition, so if the bounded complex with constructible cohomology here is arithmetic, I'll say in a minute what arithmetic means. Then the conclusion is that the little s in Simpson's theorem can be taken to be torsion. So you see there is no Durham site here. because that's a motivation. And consequently, you do not assume, you do not have to assume that X is smooth. Normal is enough. So, well, maybe I say later what is arithmetic, maybe not essential to the lecture. Let me say one more point here, which I have forgotten. So Simpson proves more. In the case where it's smooth projective, he proves that under his assumption, the T's which are produced, so his T's, are motivic, in quotation mark, i.e., that the T produces out of S which is closed such that the Riemann Hilbert of S is still closed, closed algebraic. Then it produces some T's, and the T's are motivic in the sense that there is a morphism from X to an abelian variety such that when we look at psi upper star from the character variety of A, let me just write like this, to the character variety of X, then T is precisely the image. So this last part is also true in our arithmetic situation. So we have, moreover, in the arithmetic situation, a context, let's say, then there is a psi from the regular part of X to a semi-abelian variety such that the T we have is, I mean, for each T there is, or maybe we should say a psi T here. So for each T, each T comes really from geometry. So this is the image of psi upper star. So on this, I will not really say where it's, so I can say in a word, this second theorem here, so motivicity here comes, so motivicity for Carlos, it comes from a very, precise study of, in particular, of irregular singularities at infinity. When we take S, we take its equation in the character variety, which is affine, and then it studies what happens at infinity, so it's a sort of irregularity study. Here, the motivicity comes ultimately from Faltings' theorem. Faltings' theorem on the Tet conjecture, on fields of finite type, over Q. So I don't, I will not. Okay, so that's the presentation of the result. So let me say roughly, because how to think of this. Okay. So the method of proofs has two aspects. So method of proof. It has two aspects. One aspect is analytic geometry, but p-adic analytic geometry. And another point is the study of the Galois group, of the Galois operation, which is not due to us, which comes back to a theorem of Bogomolov. And I will say a word of this. So let me start with this here. So we have this map phi here. So let me recall the map phi here. We had the map from half little pi, that's the profinite groups, with values in QP bar cross into the character variety here over QP bar phi. In fact, in it here, we can consider here when we have pi, the profinite completion, we can take the propy quotient. So that's the propy quotient. And then in the propy quotient, we can kill the torsion here. So that defines for us a sub here, which is, I should say, continuous, it's crucial. So continuous homomorphism from little pi to this quotient here. So now, one strength of p-adic geometry is that this space here can be identified via the, because on this, there's one thing we can observe here is that when we look at QP bar, so we look at the residual representation, it has values in FP bar cross, but FP bar cross, it's pardon me? Because, yeah, I apologize. Thank you very much. Thank you for the correction. Thank you. That was your concern. Thank you. So, you observe that when you look at the finite level here, the quotient FP cross and FQ cross, it has order prime to P. So when you go to the propy completion, then the residual representation is one. So that means there is enough p divisible, the rest is p divisible, and there is enough p divisibility to define the log and the exponential function. So this space here is identified via log with the tangent space at one of this one. Tangent space at one of this home here. I'm sorry, with, let me write here, T1 of what is written here. So this is a small remark here. And an important point is that one can do a sort of tet geometry with this group here. And I don't go into the details, but we can think. So here we have the Zariski topology. And here we have a profinite topology. I mean, we have a p-adic topology. And it happens that phi is continuous for the two topologies. And let me write more precisely what consequences it has. Namely, if we let me just list a few points here. If we take phi inverse of S, and we intersect it with, I should introduce a new notation, but it doesn't really help if I make a lot of notation. I can intersect phi inverse of S with this subspace, which is a tangent space, and identified with a tangent space, and inside of the tangent space, I can intersect with small balls. So let me write it like this. It's very unprecisely written. So let me write here T1 as this subgroup here, and let me write here rho for rho small. Then it happens that this is analytic subspace of this hump here. Or let me write here T1. It's an analytic subspace, and in addition, the standard properties from a rigid geometry tell us the following. Is that if we take a component S prime in S, which is such that phi inverse of S prime is not empty, then it is a case that if we take phi of phi inverse S prime, and from it, the Zariski closure, then it is precisely S prime. So that means it's like in complex geometry, if you take a ball inside of an irreducible variety, a complex ball inside of an irreducible complex variety, and you take the Zariski closure, then it is a whole variety. So this is true here as well, but more is true, namely, if phi inverse of S prime itself is a subgroup, it makes sense because we are in a linear space here, then the S prime itself will be a subgroup scheme. Okay. Ah, it's not good what I'm doing. Okay. So, it's a very rough thing, and a very rough presentation here. And now the Galois action here is used in the following way, via a theorem of Bogomolov, which I'm now going to write it. So here I'm simplifying the discussion by assuming that X is smooth projective. Then Bogomolov shows that there is a sigma in the Galois group which acts as a homotety with a factor alpha in ZP cross on the homology, so on H lower one ZP. And as a homotety with factor alpha, and this alpha is not a root of unity, so let's say of infinite order. So this theorem, because we use it in the mixed case also, in the mixed case, so X smooth quasi-projective, this has been generalized in a standard way by Daniel Litt, and I don't write what is precisely the result, and this extends also to our situation, to the normal quasi-projective case. So that is easy to see. So, but for simplicity, let us stick here. And one uses this element here to show that the I lose my brain here. One uses to show that those spaces which I have written here, which are analytic, so that let me write those ones here. So that means inverse image here. They are conical. I mean, it's more or less intuitive that if we have a homotety acting on this space, then it will be conical around the zero point or the one point, I mean, the unit character. So now you do geometry because you have a conical set which is coming from Galois theory, and you want to make out of this conical set an analytic subgroup, abelian subgroup. So it will be the case, like in complex geometry, if the summit of your cone is smooth. Because if you have a conical set in a vector space, and then the summit is smooth, then it is a sub it is a subgroup. So the point is to show that it's possible to translate your problem with a character, with a point of your variety, which is smooth and on which the Galois group is acting. So, not the Galois group, it's too much, but your sigma. So the point is to show there are smooth points which are acting on by sigma. But in fact, sigma, the only thing which is used, obviously, when I say conical, is maybe not sigma, but maybe the square of sigma, or the third power of sigma, some power of sigma, because that doesn't change the fact, because sigma is a homotety of infinite order, I can apply it to any power of sigma. So let's say, acted on by sigma m for some m, at least one. But how to find those points? I mean, the only way I have is to say the torsion points are dense. Because on a torsion point, sigma is going to, not sigma itself, but some power of sigma is going to act. And I'm going to be, if it's dense, it will meet the good locus. So, and this is one part of the theorem which is behind. is that on the components which heat, which contain integral points, so for S prime, such that phi inverse of S prime is not empty, then torsion points are dense. So, and maybe I don't say anything on this because we already enter rigid analytic geometry. And so I just say this is the mathematics which are behind. So now let me. Let me now comment in the remaining time on one corollary of the theorem, which I haven't yet written because I want to discuss it in view of a possible higher rank analog. So let us observe the following, is that the main theorem, which is the fact that phi inverse of S is not empty and it is acted on by G, implies that the components implies union of A plus T. Let me say like this. This main theorem implies the following corollary. And let me write properly because it's, I think, interesting from another viewpoint. In fact, I'm not very precise here. I should say plus motivicity imply. So to say we implies the following consequence here. Okay, so the theorem is formulated if we give ourselves a P. So let me write explicitly here. The theorem is formulated once we give ourselves P. But on the other hand, the result is that if we have this subvariety here, S, let me say for short, it is integral and it is Galois invariant. Let me summarize here the content of the assumption. Then, at the end, it is a union of tori translated by torsion points, but more is true, it is motivic, that means it comes really from a morphism from the initial normal variety, the regular points of the normal variety, to some semi-abelian variety. And this fact enables us to say the following, is that once we give ourselves P and we have our assumption and we can conclude, then in fact, the final result does not really depend on P in the following manner. So the final result no longer sees P. So this is in the following sense. So we give ourselves another P, let's say P prime. Then we have an isomorphy, so those character varieties, so we look at the character variety here over QP bar, and we can look at it over QP bar prime. So of course, any isomorphism from QP bar to QP prime bar, which can be only an algebraic isomorphism, because the topologies are not the same, establishes an isomorphism between the two schemes, not schemes over the ground field, but as abstract schemes. So we have here an isomorphism, which is coming, if you like, you put a iota here, it's coming from iota. Now we have defined here our map here, phi, from the continuous homomorphism from little pi to QP bar cross. And we can similarly define the map from the continuous homomorphism from little pi to QP prime bar cross. Let us denote it by phi prime. Now, here, we could identify those two moduli spaces here because it was just a matter of identifying one ground field with another one, which we can do algebraically. But here, because we are looking at continuous homomorphism, there is no way, there is no such map. That doesn't exist. But on the other hand, we had seen that the tori here were coming from a map from the regular open of the variety to a semi-abelian variety. So this one has nothing to do with our QP bar. And the corollary, so let me write, so we obtain, so corollary of the main theorem including multiplicity, is that if we look at, let me take the correct notation here that I don't erase three times here. So we can look here at S, and we can look at iota of S. And then the theorem, the corollary, is telling us that if S is integral, so so that means and G acts on phi inverse of S, then S prime is integral. And that's the same G here. So because the G comes, the action of G is on little pi here. Even though we don't have a map, the G part here is the same. So we have here S prime is integral, and G acts on phi prime inverse of S prime. So you see here, this is quite interesting because this enables us to pose, to make a sort of a conjecture or question, problem. And I will finish with this. Assume now we have, we consider no longer the character varieties, that means a local system of rank one, but higher rank local systems. So let me denote by, what I denoted by the character variety here, I'm going to denote by M, if you like, Betty. But coming from irreducible local system on X of S. X of C, I apologize. Is that okay? And now I'm going to consider, again, I'm going to consider it over QP bar. Okay. And again, inside, I have from continuous. And now it's no longer the abelian, the pro-finite completion of the abelian part of the fundamental group, but that's the whole fundamental group. Let me write here pi one et al of x of c with values in, so we fix a rank here. The rank of the local system, and we write here GLR. And now QP bar. Is that okay? So that is our phi. And again, we have a Galois action. So Galois action means, again, that X is defined over F field of finite type over Q, and we have the Galois action coming from this embedding here. And then we can ask again that if we assume that we have a closed variety here, closed subset, which is integral, so that means the shadow here, this analytic shadow is not trivial, and in addition it is Galois invariant, so we have S here, and we have here phi inverse of S, which is not empty and it is acted on by G, then we ask whether if we change, if we give ourselves an abstract isomorphism from QP bar to QP bar prime, that's going to give us, again, an abstract isomorphism here. And then we have our map phi prime, and we have the corresponding thing here, GLQ bar phi prime, so pi one et al, and continuous, fxc. Then we can ask the same thing, namely, does that imply that phi prime inverse of iota of S is again not empty and acted on by G? It's a very strong thing. And if we had a positive answer applied, even if X is a smooth projective, so applied to S equals the isolated points, of the Betti moduli, this would imply that they are integral. I.e., they would come from a representation from pi one, now pi one topological of xc into glrz bar. So this is, of course, and here so that is a Simpson's conjecture. Because isolated points here is they are called rigid local system. So Simpson conjecture is that rigid. So X is most projective here, maybe for Simpson conjecture. Otherwise, I have to say more, and I don't want to say more. So rigid local systems are integral. And with Michael Groschenig, and I finish with this, I have half a minute, with Michael Groschenig, we could prove Simpson conjecture, but under a possibly stronger assumption, namely that not only they are rigid, but they are cohomologically rigid. Cohomologically rigid implies integrality. But here, this formulation here, which I can say just in one more, doesn't go to the mod p variety, but goes periodically, directly, on the same variety. This would enable you, this would enable us to prove the full strength of this question here. But this is much more general because you can forget the specificity of rigid local system and just consider, as Simpson did in another work, any sub-loci of the character variety or more generally of the Betti moduli. And I stop here and thank you for your attention. Yeah, sure. Can.
What does mean S to be motivic for high rank case?
Yes.
What does mean that?
What does that mean?
Yeah.
Well, motivic.
For high rank.
Yes, it's a good question, but I'm not a motivic person, so I hate those words. So at any rate, it means integral. I mean, it contains integrality assumption. And that is a very precise formulation. I mean, this one is a very precise formulation. Now, motivic, you could say that you have a parameter space. I make a try, but maybe the try is not quite correct. Maybe something like this, so you have X here, and you have a parameter space. I don't want to call it S because I'm not, and T here, and you have a family here. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Let's say F, and maybe this one we assume smooth proper. I'm just making it up, okay? And then this one, so you fix an I here, or N, let's say, and then you look at Rn F lower star, and then this gives you a map from T to your character variety, to your moduli. Okay. That should be contained in the definition of motivic. But in fact, more is true because it should be also when we say motivic, we for if t is just one point, then we don't allow only this, but we allow subquotients. So now I'm not certain how to explain the notion of subquotient in a family here. It has so because or maybe you say a subquotient of this thing, and then so I'm not quite sure here. Okay, so I'm not certain here.
The question? Okay, so that's the same.